fantastic story. You know, all of us see, living in India, you see children, you know, as you drive through under like flyovers, you see kids who are not in school. And so one day, this woman, Jyoti Tanna, started talking to them. You know, there's a big traffic light, and she sees these kids every day trying to make an extra buck, trying to, you know, rupee or two, trying to clean the windshield, and she rolled down the window and said, "Why are you not in school?" And they said, "Oh, we don't understand what's going on in the class. One child said, I don't have money for books and uniforms." Someone, they all gave some reasons. And she said, "If I teach you and I give you, and I buy your uniform and your books, will you go to school?" And they said, "Yes." And she said, "Here's my number. Ask you and your parent to come to my house tomorrow at this and this time." And out of the five kids there, four of them showed up to her house. And she started a program where she worked with them to get them back into school, and an after-school support program, because most of these children are first-generation learners, and they're not able to get the support they need at home. So the kind of support that your parents are able to give you, they don't have that at home, and oftentimes they have chores to do because both parents are working until quite late. They have to take care of little siblings. And so she started this after-school program that now, 35 years later, is massive. There's 10,000 kids that have gone through it. It's an urban program. There's also rural projects. There's vocational training. So the concept of the program is that you take a child who is highly likely to drop out because they're not succeeding in school, and you provide them an after-school setup. What they need to sort of understand, you know, learn how to learn, is that, you know, in a school like AES, you have the privilege of being taught how to learn, and so learning becomes easier. But in a lot of the government schools, you have 40, 50, 60 kids in a class at times, and it's extremely difficult to keep up with what's going on. So this after-school program, the concept that she started, is, and it's not just academic, it's also looking at holistic development. So basically the math and the English is the things that you sort of focus on, but alongside with them, you also work with activities, field trips, sports, dance, music, things that government schools in India don't provide, extracurricular stuff that, you know, you guys all love. That's what makes school so fun. And so we do that also as part of Each One Teach One. And then oftentimes you have, you know, kids who were literally plucked off the street and found themselves through Each One Teach One then moving on. I mean, there's kids who have gone on and getting, you know, fantastic jobs because they sort of learned how to dream, basically. They learned how to dream. Someone helped them think bigger dreams. Otherwise, the other aspect that you find is that they didn't have role models in their society, is that the biggest dream they could imagine is that they could be a driver or be a guard or be a gardener. And so you invite speakers in from different backgrounds, from different professions, to sort of be like, no, you can do more. Like, you can do that if you're not getting an education, but if you're getting an education, there's so many other options for you. And if you think about it, all of you have role models that you're surrounded by. Adults who you can look up to, who you can say, oh wow, that's such an interesting job, I want to do that. So without that aspect, you know, you're constantly surrounded by inspiring adults. And all these people give you inspiration and give you ideas and say, oh wait, how did you come into this field? So we also do that as part of Each One Teach One, is that we invite people in from different backgrounds, from, you know, I had a graphics designer come in, I had, you know, just artists, musicians, people who have different professions. Now, the whole concept of Each One Teach One is that we want the kids to not feel like we're doing charity. Like, the whole concept is built around the fact that we're working with you, and then it is your responsibility to work with another child, either through time, through money, or, you know, through your talent. So I would say like 90% of the children who have gone through are coming back either to give their time or, you know, tutor another child, or to organize an event, a picnic, you know, a talent show. So it is entirely run by ex-students. A lot of these activities are entirely run by ex-students, because ex-students of Each One Teach One are realizing the benefit they got from the mentoring that they received. So that's a fantastic aspect of Each One Teach One. And so this started in Mumbai 30 years ago, and from 4 it become 20, and from 20 become 80, and from, you know, the numbers keep going, because each year you take on another batch of kids, you add another school. So about 18 months ago, about 18 months ago, I started, me and Pratiksha, who's another parent of the school, Anika Samaya's mom, we started the Delhi chapter of Each One Teach One. And so we took on a school, actually just in our community in Maljamarg, is a local government school. We took eighth grade level children, and supported them in this program, and now we have added 9th and 10th grades as well. So it's a daily program. We have teachers who come and work with them, and we take them on field trips and museums and outings and do sports and, you know, things that they don't have access to. So for example, I'm working with Dr. Fraser to have the kids come and do science here because they don't have a science lab. And if they do have, the teacher does experiments and they don't get to do it themselves. So there's so many things that you in the school might take for granted, saying all schools are like that, but no, all schools are not like that. They don't have a PE teacher, they don't have art, they don't have dance, they don't have music, they don't have sports. So imagine school without any of those things. It'd be kind of boring, don't you think? So we're trying to sort of provide those enrichment activities that gets kids excited about learning. It's also the softer side that we're trying to provide, is that, you know, someone is caring for them. It's like, ultimately, they keep coming every day. Why? Because someone cares for them. Someone is looking out for their future. So you know, as teachers and me in the program, you develop a personal bond with the child where they can start opening up about their life. And they come from really difficult backgrounds. They have alcoholic fathers, they have, you know, getting sexually abused at home, and they live, most of them live in Sanjay camp and Vivekananda camp and in the servant quarters. So basically, the kids in this school are kids of staff of Janakipuri, or like in embassy staff, you know? So these are kids in our community, basically. And now, if I live in Maljamarg as well, if I just walk to school at 8:30 in the morning, I have like 80 kids. I'm like, hi, ma'am. It's really a personal bond at this point, where they can call me up and say, this is happening, this is an urgent situation in their life, and we try and help them through counseling and through other ways. So that's Each One Teach One. It'll slowly grow. The next step that we're doing for Each One Teach One is a sort of combined project that. So I've known Kailash Chaturvedi for a really long time, and he does this fantastic project. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's a rural development project to eradicate child labor and to eradicate child marriage. So he works, it's called Bal Mitragram, Child Friendly Village. It's been around for 20 years, and it's in about 600 villages all across India. So I would always tell Kailash Chaturvedi that his village program is a fantastic project. It's a 3-year project where you work with the community to create child leaders where they can advocate for their own, for themselves with the adults. So imagine if you were living in a village and you had, you know, this group of you or child leaders elected as child leaders to represent your community, as children. And you as children say, we don't have, you know, bathroom facilities in our school, and our teachers are not coming, and, you know, a whole host of other problems that you might think about. Oh, we found a blizzard in our food, whatever it might be. You as a child leader can report that to the adult leaders of the community and learn how to advocate for yourselves. Because ultimately, the biggest problem is that children don't know their rights here. It is their right to go to school. Every child has a right to go to school. And that school needs to be in an urban setting within 1 kilometer radius. So kids don't know that. They don't realize that that is their right. And they can stand up for themselves. No, I have to go to school. They can stand up to their parents. They can stand up to their families, they can stand up to anyone. Say, I have a right to go to school, I'm a child, I don't need to work. And the whole concept around it is that if a child is working, they are taking employment away from an adult. So why is a child working? Because they can be paid a lot less, and they're vulnerable. They can be bullied, a lot more work can be extracted from them. So ultimately, it's changing the mindset of the community, is that by putting your child to work, you are taking a job away from youth that are in the village. And so having a 10-year-old not go to school and be in a work setting, not only are they subject to all sorts of, you know, horrific situations where the employer treats them poorly, they don't get paid properly. Oftentimes children get paid a small fraction of what the adult pays because they feel like they can do it. And so why are children being employed? Because it is cheap labor. And they don't stand up for themselves, they can't fight. And so employers take children to work for that reason. So slowly, it's a 3-year project, this child-friendly village idea, and it's a project to basically get all kids out of labor and into school and have children advocate for themselves that we don't want to get married before a certain age and we have to go to school. It takes quite a long time. It's a three-year program, and you create children's groups, you create youth groups, you create women's groups who are doing the same thing in women. You know, women have their own issues that they're facing. And so ultimately, the program also tries to bring together, see, the thing is that if they're ultimately, and that's the hard part with all of this, is that a child will only be successful if all the different aspects are met. So if there's a good school nearby and the teachers are great and everything's great, some NGO worked really hard to get a fantastic education system right next to the village, but they didn't take care of the water. They didn't take care of, you know, drinking water. So, for example, you might have a fantastic school, but you have children getting sick all the time. And by children getting sick all the time, they're missing school and they're falling behind, and then they lose interest. They don't understand what's going on in class. So what this program also tries to do is work on malnutrition, or work on health and hygiene, to work on sanitation issues, so that ultimately, you know, all these problems are connected. I mean, if you think of a mine, right? I always like to use the mine analogy. There are all these holes that kids fall into. And from a focus perspective, an NGO can say, oh, I'm focused on education. But actually, for a child to be successful, there has to be so many aspects that have to be addressed. That, you know, if there's a good school and they have good teachers, great. But they also need to have good sanitation so that they're not falling sick all the time. They're not getting typhoid and malaria and dengue and all these other horrible diseases, HEP, that keep them from attending school. So, well, that's the other aspect of the program. Through my work with Each One Teach One, I started to understand the issues that the urban kids are facing. So I told Kailashi that, you know, a lot of the work that you're doing in the rural areas is just as relevant, if not more, in the urban setting. Now, with small tweaks to the program, we can make it to be a fantastic project. So I'm working on a project now with them. That's a community, like a slum community development project. Same concept where you had in the urban setting, but in the rural setting, but in the urban program. So one of the communities that we're supporting is Sanjay Camp, which is next to the Rail Museum. Have you guys been to the Rail Museum? It's very close by. It's near Primus Hospital, just on the St. Chandragupta Mark. And it's a huge community. It's about 4,000 households. And in a room of this size, there are probably 8 families, 8 houses. So if you think of the end of this blue sofa to the end where Mark is sitting, that little square is as this typical size of a home for a family of 6 to 8 people. So you get a sense of the living conditions, and they don't have their own toilets. They don't have water. And I think that's the thing to realize is that, okay, this is Chanakipuri, it's surrounded by embassies, so many swimming pools are around. We, you know, take long showers, and just down the street, there are people who don't have running water to themselves. They don't have their own toilets. They have to go for shared toilet facilities. And sometimes, as you hear, you know, a big part of Each One Teach One is sharing and talking. So we have these meditation circles, and we share problems. And the fears that they have, you know, like you guys don't have a fear of going to the bathroom at night because you have a safe place to go. And so some of these girls say, we're scared to go to the bathroom at night because the toilet is an 8-minute walk and there's drunk people around. And so we don't drink water after 6:30 in the evening because we don't want to go into the dark to go to the bathroom. So you get a sense of the problems that they're facing and you just want to do something. So this project that we're working on, it just started. Similar concept is that we want to work to get all kids back into school. So at this point, we're doing the household survey. We're going house by house and understanding who lives in that home, how many kids are there, who goes to school, who doesn't go to school. And if they don't go to school, are they working? And already, you know, we started enrolling the little kids into school. And oftentimes what's happening is that both parents go to work and a 3-year-old is left sort of, you know, in the community to wander around. And you know, there's all sorts of risks. So you take a huge community like this and you divide them into different categories. So there's kids who are under 6 who are not in a preschool, it's called Aanganwadi. I don't know if you've heard that word. It's like a, it's a government-supported program where kids have a daycare kind of space in the slum. But not all kids go to it. So Aanganwadis make sure that all kids under six are going to a safe facility to play or learn. For kids who are between the ages of 6 and 14 and are not going to school, to enroll them back into school. And it's not that easy. You know, if you have an 11-year-old who's never been to school, it's not like, oh, let me just walk them over to school and sign their paperwork. No. You have to spend sometimes 6 months to a year to have them learn enough so that they can be in school, because it's very easy to enroll them in school, but it's super difficult to keep them in school, because by that time they're so far behind that they don't know their alphabet, they don't know their numbers fully, you know, and to come in into their grade level is extremely difficult, and no principal of the school wants to take an 11-year-old in a first grade classroom. So Each One Teach One and Kailash Chitra at the Youth Children's Foundation are partnering so that Kailashi's organization will work on the community at large, and we'll have different NGOs that are working on different aspects. So Each One Teach One will work on getting the dropped-out kids ready to be mainstreamed back into school. And we'll have a project within the community where we hire youth. So, for example, the other thing that I was telling you is that they don't have role models, right? And so I was telling this to the organization is that, you know, ultimately, let's say some small percentage of the kids in the community, they study super hard, they're really dedicated, they get great grades, and they pass. They get to 12th grade and they finish high school. Yay, so awesome. But in the end, if they don't get a job or have a, you know, a career, they're not going to be role models to their younger siblings. Their sixth grader brother will be like, oh, my brother worked so hard, but see, he's going to get a job. And it's not inspiring, you know. So as you're working in the community project, you're also trying to work on livelihood for children who are finished high school. So you've 12th grade pass. There's other NGOs that provide livelihood for older kids. And our NGO can hire these kids to work with. So for example, yesterday I was in the community and I met this wonderful 19-year-old who has finished 12th grade. And she got fabulous grades, but she's not able to get a job because they don't have career counseling. They don't have someone helping them with what's next for them. And I was like, well, what are you doing? She's like, I'm trying my hardest to help the community learn how to read and work with the adults who don't know how to read. And I was like, well, would you be interested in a job, like a part-time job with us, where you work formally with children who are not attending school and you teach them every day for 3 hours? She's like, I love it. So ultimately, you start making change by employing the youth within the community to advocate for education. And they see that that's how you can move forward, is that, you know, when you're trying to change the mindset of a community, it takes a long time and you have to go slowly. There's no like quick measures. You can't just be like, oh, I'll enroll them into school and they'll stay in school. No, unfortunately not. It's a very slow process of change. The kids who are not going to school between the ages of 3 to 6, it's quite straightforward because they're not behind. So you can simply work with the parent, get the paperwork in, counsel them on the value of education, and be pretty sure that most likely they'll be okay. But the kids who are older, you have to work with them in a special program. There's also kids who are slow learners because of malnourishment, and you need to work with them also on a different level. And the government of India, I have to say, like, they do try, but the problem is that there's so many schemes out there for people who are really poor, below the poverty line. I don't know if you've heard of the term BPL, below the poverty line. It's a term in India. So the majority of the people who are living in slum communities are BPL card holders. You get a card if you're below the poverty line. And I don't know the exact amount. I think you have to earn less than 18,000, something like that. You can look up the numbers. So, for example, no one in the slum community knows that if you have a BPL card, you have 50,000 rupees worth of free healthcare. You can go to any hospital, and as long as you're enrolled into that government scheme, you can walk into any hospital and get free medical care. No one knows that, because the people who know that are not the ones who need it. I know it. I don't have a BPL card. I know it because I know how to internet research and I know how to enroll myself. So the government, while has done a decent job in setting up these schemes, the people who need these schemes are not educated and literate to avail of those. So that's the other aspect of the program, is that, you know, if you're a widow and you have kids, then the government can support you. They'll give you a small sum of money. And if you have a disability and you're a BPL card holder, they'll give you, there's so many schemes that you can take advantages of. And that's the other aspect of the program, is to learn how to help themselves. Is that ultimately, the point of the program is to not disempower them by doing everything for them. The point of the program is to empower them, is to help them think through how to advocate for themselves, how to stand up for themselves, how to fight for their rights. Because a poor, illiterate person doesn't know how to do that. They just don't. So for example, I'll tell you, in Sanjay Camp, there was probably about 400 to 500 kids from the community who were attending a school that was so convenient, just like at the edge of the community, there was a government school. And one fine day, the government school decided to shut down. And it was a really big deal. It was a primary school. So it was super convenient for the slum community to walk over to school and send their kids there. The school shut down for no real apparent reason that the community seemed to know about. And so many kids who didn't have older siblings to walk to school with have dropped out for that reason. Because the school shut down, they tried to advocate for themselves, they tried to write letters, didn't work. And now the school, some kids re-enrolled to a farther off school, but in order to go to the school, you have to cross a railway track. And there are so many accidents that happen that, you know, simply crossing a little 5-year-old or a little 8-year-old crossing a railway line, not able to judge, oh, the train is coming, I better not cross right now. So you realize that some of these problems that they're facing are huge and they don't know how to get around it. So that's the other aspect that we're trying to work with them in, is teaching them how to fight for their rights with the government and advocate for themselves, how to write letters, how to contact the right people. Because they're in Janakipuri, they have the largest voting rights because there's 10,000, 9,000 something residents in. So in the sort of district of Janakipuri, in the ward of Janakipuri, our ward at the school, they have the largest constituency for voting. So they actually have a lot of power. But that power doesn't amount to much if they don't know their rights. So that's another aspect of the program. So as you can imagine, we're working with the kids, we're working with the youth, we're working with the women, we're working with... Now, we're not going to work per se directly with the drug addiction issues in the adult community because it's too complicated. When you enter a community, now I've been spending a lot of time in the slum community, you enter and everybody wants you to sit down and they want you to hear their problems, every single person, because they love talking about their problems. They have someone to explain, oh, this happened and then this happened and then we have this. So ultimately, as an organization, we are being very selective. These are our main four focus areas. We're only going to work on this. And that's not to say that we're not going to listen, but it means that we're going to slowly divert their conversation to, let's talk about your children. Because ultimately, the path to breaking the cycle of poverty is through education. And to work with the parent on really internalizing that. So you can say, oh wow, the path to breaking the cycle of poverty is through education, but you don't have livelihood programs for the educated youth, that doesn't ring true anymore. Okay, yeah, my brother's daughter finished 12th grade, but look, she's still sitting around. She has no income. She worked so hard. We put her in tuition programs. We did this. No. So you have to create role models within their community so that younger kids are inspired to be like, wow, I want to be like that person. She got such a good job here. And so you invite people from the community. So, for example, there's a fantastic kid from Vivekananda camp who used to work at AES. Mark, I think you were here at that time when he was still working there. Mm-hmm. Lal Singh or something.
Yeah, Lal.
Fantastic. So he would be a fantastic, I'm giving you an example of someone who would be a fantastic speaker because he now has his own house. He still visits his parents still live there.
Still
he
there.
Stepped back, he got an education, and how did he do it? And I met with him and I said, look, I really want you to come and speak to my kids because they need to hear stories like this. He said, I was not a serious student, I would fail all the time, and he failed his 10th grade exam, he failed. And he said, that's it, I'm just going to go into my, you know, father's like field of selling vegetables. And it was April, May. And he said it took 4 days of working in the heat when he said, I have to give it a try. If I don't try one more time, I will regret it for the rest of my life. And those 4 days, he said, they taught him more than anything. And that's, he re-enrolled into school and studied so hard, got a, you know, great results in his exam, and went on to college, worked at AES here, and has gotten his own place, and sending his kids to a fantastic school. So there are people who sort of break away from it, but those people are not back in their community, so how do they role model, right? So there are so many aspects of the program that we're working with. It's very complicated. And what I invite you to do, as you are kids in living in India, is to just observe, just look, just notice. Notice the kids that are not in school. I'm sure all of you, within months of arriving to India, would have seen kids who really should be in school. They're like 8 or 10 years old, and this is during school hours, and they're just loitering around. And just, you know, I speak Hindi, so I can say, why are you not in school? Just ask them, why are you not in school? And you start to understand the reasons. What are their reasons? Does anyone want to try and tell me some? What are some of the reasons that kids are not in school?
Lack of interest.
Yes, lack of interest.
They're sent off to work.
They're sent off to work.
Child marriage.
Child marriage. Failure. They failed in school. Caring for a baby sibling. Housework. Too far, that's definitely one issue. And not having, I mean, this is not a problem in the urban setting, but in the rural communities for sure, not having, you know, a girl who's gone to puberty and not having toilet facilities at school. In the urban situation, that doesn't happen as much now, because all the schools in Delhi, they do have bathroom facilities. There's a host of reasons. And so once you sit down with a family and say, you know, I met a family who has 6 kids, none of them are in school. Nobody goes to school. They're from ages 5 to 16. They live in Sanjay camp. And there are different reasons. Oh, she went to school but didn't understand what was going on, so she dropped out. Now, okay, another child, no, someone gave him a job and he makes enough money. He delivers water. He's a water delivery boy. He's this other son who's 12 years old, he's a kabadi bala. Have you heard of that term? Where they collect the trash and they recycle and they earn like 100 rupees. And ultimately, that little bit of income goes to the family, and some little tiny bit of it is reserved for the child, and that's exactly how they get into drugs, and you know, they have access. Once you give kids access to money at a young age, they get pulled into it. If you have a druggie who's walking around, they see a child has money, they'll, you try this, try this. So the whole premise of the program is that the safest place a child can be is school. It's much better than them loitering around the streets, to beggary, this. There's so many dangers. Sex trafficking, you know, there have been multiple cases of women, or young girls who have been picked up and not returned, missing children from the camp. So I gave you sort of a sense of what, you know, both these, I kind of love it because E21 is one world, and Kailash, I work with Kailash Chakravarti Children's Foundation in the mornings, in the afternoons I work with E21, and I love that these worlds are now coming together. And I also love that AES, which is my other world, is supporting E21. So the kids are coming here. I'm trying to think of innovative ways that, as a fantastic school we have, to find opportunities for not just my E21 kids, how AES can support the community at large. It's like, yeah, we have this fantastic school in Tanakipuri. What can we do to do more for the community? You know? So I'm working with Mark on coming up with ideas around service. And if you guys have any questions, I feel like I've talked about the time. Go ahead if you have questions.
Yeah, guys.
So do you think once the kids, like, they get good education, they graduate and they get a job, do you think they should return back to their family so they can be a good role model and help them out?
Well, it takes a lot of savings to move away from the community. So it's a big deal. I mean, oftentimes children who finish, like even the 19-year-old I met, she has small jobs she's teaching. She probably earns maybe 8 or 10,000 rupees a month. Not a whole large sum of money. But for her to break away from it, it'll take a lot more than that. It'll take years of savings. And they will live in their communities. I mean, this guy Lal Singh, sure, he only moved out recently. He was living there for a long time.
What is the process that goes through to finding missing children in the camp?
So the process that we have so far just begun is try to identify the, you know, as we're speaking family to family, we're getting reports of, oh, their daughter went missing, you know, 2 years ago and never came back. Sometimes the child goes missing for 6 months and then it sort of arrives and has been through hell in that time. They tell stories, but until you have, and the thing is, police reports are not filed as well. So that's not helpful. It's to, you know, the program, our program will work with the local community school principals, because sometimes the government school principals, the police, the nearby police, if you tell the police nearby is that we're from this and this NGO and we're working with this community, they know that there's someone else looking out for this camp. They can't just bully and they can't just ill-treat their citizens, because someone else is looking for them, looking out for them. And someone who knows that these people have rights and we're going to tell them what their rights are. And we're going to empower them to be like, you know, someone who's poor and literate, they can't stand up for their rights. So if they walk to the principal, one mother was telling me the story is that she knows that her child has a right to go to the school, but the principal said, no, she doesn't know her alphabet, I'm not taking her. She's only 7 years old. She could have gone into first grade a year later, not such a big deal. But the principal was in a bullying mood and said, no, 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 she's not going in. I said, well, what did you do? She said, I didn't know what to do. I just ran. I left. And now the child is 10. It's so much harder to get that child. You have to work with that child for 6 months, 8 months, in a small group setting to get them geared up to go back to school. So at that moment in time, they don't have the power to stand up to the authorities, to the police, so our program also is working with the, you know, I will meet with every principal. There are 18 schools around the community that the kids go to. So if I meet with the principal and say, okay, I'm from so-and-so organization, I'm working with Sanjay Camp, and there are many kids from the Sanjay Camp that come here, and I just wanted to introduce myself and working with the community so that they're going to be, hopefully, you know, help them in their community so that they become more engaged in school.
So I have a question and a follow-up question. So have you ever rescued from the streets of victim child trafficking?
Bachpan Bachao Andolan, I don't know if you've heard of BBA. So Kailash Satyarthi, you know, won the Nobel Peace Prize for rescuing children from bonded labor situations and from trafficking situations. So, yes, constantly. They're constantly rescuing children. I mean, they just rescued 19 children. 8 of them were girls. That was in the news yesterday. So actually, are you going to be at AES next year? There's a child rights club in the high school that work with rescued children that they have interaction. So like this Saturday, the club is going to work with kids who are freshly rescued and do a service program with them where they come up with games and learning. And they meet with kids who are freshly rescued from various situations, from factories. So usually it feels like the boy children are sent to factory, in like brick or garment or leather or different types of factories. And the girl children are sent as domestic staff, domestic labor, where they are victims of sexual abuse very often, or they are sold to brothels.
The high school group.
No, it's called the Child Rights Club.
Okay.
As
I'm confusing which group's going where. I thought this was involved in it this weekend on Saturday.
They're going to this group, Child Rights Club is going to Mukti Ashram.
Okay.
And there's, you know, the thing with Mukti Ashram is that it's a transient community of children because they're rescued, their paperwork is taken, and within anywhere from 2 weeks to 4 weeks they're sent back to their homes.
The follow-up question is that when you rescue a child that comes from circumstances like that, do you see any psychological effects?
Huge. And so one big aspect that you have to do is have a counselor. So the girls are sent to a girl's shelter and the boys are sent to a boy's home. And they go through, oftentimes they're coming from very terrible situations where they're you know, beaten, sexually abused, so you work with them to have a counselor work with them to sort of just be, you know, because they've been through a lot, and sometimes they're working 18-hour shifts. They're not fed properly, they're not clothed properly, and so they have a lot of psychological, you know, fears. And so as soon as one of the first things Kailashi tells me is that when kids are first rescued and they come to Mokhi Ashram, there's a lot of food, and they eat so much food because they think that this is the only meal they're going to get. And he always tells them, you're going to get food like this every meal, don't worry. But that fear that they're not going to get food, they better eat like, you know, like a camel, eat as much as possible. That's one of the first things you notice, that they have not been fed properly. So when they finally see a lot of food, they just want to eat because they're so worried they're not going to, when they don't know when their next meal would be.
Can I ask real quick, so for example, what happened yesterday, what was in the news, how did they go about this? How did they find them? How did they pull them out of the situation?
So, okay, things have changed because Kailashi's organization has passed a lot of laws. So earlier days, it had to be like sneaky, like, you know, undercover activity. Parents would tip off, an adult would tip off. They would sort of slyly in the middle of the night come and rescue the kids and take them. Now they work with the police because it's illegal to employ children under 14. It's illegal. So if you see that a child is illegally employed, you can work with the police to raid. But these raids are not as unsafe as they used to be because it's now the law. You're not allowed to work. So, you know, I'm terrible with numbers and facts, so don't ask me that stuff, but at some point, a few years back, I think 10 years ago, the laws came into place where it was illegal for children under 14 to work. And so now, ever since then, the raids have become a little easier. Still dangerous. I mean, two people from Kailash's organization have lost their lives in raids. And because the employers, they're losing cheap labor. If you rescue 30 kids from their factory, they've lost their employees. They have lost their income. So they're really bugged. They're angry. And the thing is that I don't know if you guys know about how kids even get to that situation. Most times, you know, people don't understand is that, well, why did the child end up working there? Usually, I would say most of the times, that the parent is tricked into it. So if you're working in Bihar or if you're like in some far off place, you have these middlemen who work, you know, I'll give you an example. Suppose you have a leather factory in Delhi and you know that you need 30 boys in your factory. You have a contact of a middleman who is in Bihar, say you're in Bihar, and you call and say, I need 30 boys for my factory. Middleman goes to recruit in villages nearby, fooling parents saying, oh, your child is not in school, your child really should be in school, and I will take them and allow them to go to school and then work, and I will send money back home on their behalf. Parent thinks it's a fantastic idea. They're like, wow, great, fantastic, great, please take my child. And they only realize much later on, 2 months, 3 months, when they don't hear from their child, that they have been fooled. Because they're not getting money and they've lost their child. So at the time that they're leaving, the parents are actually like excited. Oftentimes the parents are excited, oh wow, my child's gonna have future. See, ultimately, all parents, very small percentage of parents don't want their best for their children. They all want the best for their children. They get fooled into, they get tricked. They actually get tricked. And so the tip-off happens by parents, by relatives, and sometimes in the factories nearby, you know, there's a helpline. If you see children under the age of 14 working somewhere, you can call and say there are children employed at this in this place and the raid can be scheduled. You can do that. Because you'll see it. You'll see many kids that are working. And the thing is, the mindset in India is still such, I mean, I have educated friends who say, oh, but you know, they have a 12-year-old working in their homes, cleaning and cooking. And their mindset, it's a mentality here that, oh, they're still better off working in my house than living in the village. I'm giving them a means to support their family. Now, you have to get stand up to them as well and say, but why are they not in school? You're working for you is keeping them from attending school, and an older person can work on their job. Why does a child have to work here? So, I mean, it's not just the illiterate who, you know, there are plenty of educated people in Delhi who think there's nothing wrong in keeping a 12-year-old to cook and clean their home. I have friends, actually have now, I don't feel like I can call them friends, but yeah, they employ girl children in their house and keep them from going to school. And I tell them, I'm like, well, tell them that the only way they're allowed to work in your house is if they go to school. See, working is not that bad, as long as they're going to school. If they go to school and you give them a safe space to work from the hours after school, from they can work from 4 to 7, and you help them with their studies so they can succeed at school, okay. Then they can work in their homes. But don't keep them from school, because you're not giving them any future by keeping them from school.
So, while I was doing research, I noticed that one of the causes that children don't go to school is because they're lacking interest in going to school. Does this relate to like the children's parents that also didn't go to school?
Huge. Because, you know, the thing is, they feel when you're managing your survival, when you don't have food to eat and you are, the education just feels like, what's the point? How will I get, the word is rosy roti, daily food. In Hindi, it's rosy roti. How will I get my rosy roti? How will I get my daily food? Because they're so poor that they're just fighting for survival. So education feels like that'll help me 10 years down the road. I want food now. So they would gladly send their child to earn 50 rupees at a chai stand if they could help their income. So that's what it means, is if you're that poor to. And you can say, but you know, putting your child into school means that they can earn more later. Well, unless you help them. See, ultimately, when you have people who are that poor, you have to work with them to increase their livelihood, so that they can earn. So there's another aspect of our program is working with corporates to give livelihood to women. There's women who have too many children who are living there, but there's plenty of things they can do while they're working from home. They can make beads, they can make jewelry. So you have corporates, part of their CSR activity is to come and teach the women there how to, you know, if they're making necklaces, how to make paper bags. So we can have workshops for the women so that they then don't have to put the pressure of earning on their children.
Just one other thing. So if their parents don't go to school, like when they were young, will this affect them, like also
maybe
not going to school?
I mean, the thing is, the push for education comes from the parents. I'm finding, as I'm speaking to the parents, is that if the mother is like, you must go to school, and they stand on it, then the child will likely go to school. If the mother is like, no, forget it, what's the point? Oh, you know, just deliver water and earn a bit of money, it's okay. If the mother is not on it, sometimes parents, the kids don't go to school or they drop out. So lack of interest, it's kind of like a funny term. Lack of interest means that they just, it's an ignorance about their rights. See, the thing is, many times you ask about children, they jump on hair, like they say, no, we don't want to go, we don't understand, it's not fun. Children want to have fun. Schools are not always fun, and they're, especially if they're not learning and they're falling behind. They're not enjoying themselves. So a big part of our program, for the first month, it's only activities. To entice the children to come to a daily program, to not go to work, is to entice them by having fun. You have fun. Games, and you have, you know, sports, and you have dance, and you have music, and you get to a routine where you do that every day, and you sneak in education. Slowly you bring in the math and the learning and the phonics. It's like on the slide, because they're not used to sitting down and learning like that. And then once they get attached to you and you build a bond with them, you can slowly work with them on a daily basis, and they get to a rhythm where they start to enjoy it.
I remember going to one of Kailash Chaturthi's ashrams, and I've seen like rescued girls there and there were boys.
Yeah, the girls are sent to a different shelter. So by Indian law, the Children and Welfare Committee, they have to separate the rescued girl children from the rescued boy children. So his shelter in Mukti Ashram is a boys' home. The girls that they rescue are sent to another place that's not run by Kailash Chaturthi. So they can do a raid and rescue girls, but the girls are sent to another shelter. There's several of them in Delhi.
Are there kids in Ichuan, Tichuan who want to go to school but can't because their parents are unemployed and someone has to earn money for them?
Definitely, definitely. And it takes time to tell the parents. See, sometimes your parent, the dad is an alcoholic, he's not earning. The mother is under, they have six children. And her 8,000 rupees doesn't go far enough because the husband uses that some of that money for alcohol and gets violent and aggressive. And suddenly, sending their child to school is not the priority. Sending their child is like just providing for six kids and getting food on the table is the priority. And so it takes time. You know, you really have to counsel and work with individual families. It's a very slow process for change.
Do you think the government should have a bigger role in like what you guys are doing in your NGOs?
Definitely, definitely the government. The problem is that the problems are so vast in this country, and the country itself is so vast, and there's such a huge population in your population project that the government, you know, I have to say, they do have the basic constructs there. They have policies in place to help. There's government schools or this, but there's people at every level who are taking advantage. There's corruption. There's, and like I said, the people who need to avail of these schemes don't have the knowledge or the education to enroll themselves in them. So, yes, wouldn't it be great if your one BPL card automatically enrolled you to every government scheme that you are eligible for? But that's not how it works. It's too big of a country. So, if you're a widow and you don't know that there's a scheme for widows, because you don't know, you're not reading. I mean, most of the women in the center camp, they don't know how to read and write. They can't operate an ATM machine. So how many times do my H1 teacher kids have to be pulled out of school so that their mother can go to the ATM machine? Can you imagine? If your mom kid said, hey, come, I don't know how to operate the machine, come miss school, take me to the bank. So common. Because their kids are the only people in the house they can read and write. It's a crazy reality out there. And I think if you try and think of it from their perspective, you get a sense of how vulnerable they are. Really very vulnerable without education. The amount of reading and writing that we need to survive in the world. I mean, you know, just barely they know how to operate their phones. They can get swindled in terms of purchases, in terms of accounts, in terms. Any other questions?
Just kind of on that note, is there any kind of program for educational mothers?
Yes. We work in the women's group. The same youth who are educated are working with the, are going to be working with the mothers as well. For basic, I mean, you can't make a read, operate the ATM, you know, you can have like, and the thing is, you know, I was telling Kailashi, this is to, you know, there's so many NGOs that are doing good work, and Kailashi's organization should own the project and partner with different NGOs. Not 20 of them, but maybe 5 NGOs on different areas of their own expertise, because each one teacher might be good at education, there might be someone else who might be good at malnutrition, and someone else who might be good at counseling. So it's, instead of us trying to do everything, it's better to form good alliances and call them in for different areas of expertise.
How does caste play a role in their mindset when it comes to education?
Caste? You know, the kids that I work with in Ichuan Tichuan, caste has not been something that has come up. It feels that the adults are more conscious of caste than the children are, at least from my small perspective. Now, I'm sure that there is bullying going on around caste in the camp. And there's us versus them. Oh, you're this and you're that. But that probably happens in all levels of society. I mean, I've just heard about the stuff that's gone on in middle school. So that that concept of bullying is happening at various classes of society.
I'm getting at more of like the decision to go to school or not. You know, with parents and children both.
Definitely.
Like, does it create a mindset?
Yeah, totally.
They don't think they're worthy.
They don't think they're they're worthy and their family has collected trash for the last 50 years, and so they think that's a perfectly fine thing to do, and they won't, they feel they won't be welcome at school.
So how many cats do you think would be? It's not like everyone's on the cat in one cat.
No, not at all. It's far too vast.
Yeah.
And it's mostly migrants from different places, so.
I have so many questions.
Yeah.
Do you guys have?
Well, now that you know the Thunder Camp, I mean, it is walking distance from here. And I don't invite you to go there, but I invite you to keep an eye out. Is that it's behind the Korean embassy. It's basically, Thunder Camp has 14 embassies around it. So one of our programs is going to be working with embassies and saying, look, these are the children of your staff. They're gardeners, the guards, the cooks, these are their children. And so ultimately, when you're an embassy in this city, don't you want to do something for the host country? And there's so many ways that embassies can support. There's so many ways. And so, you know, I always believe that everybody wants to do good, but they don't know how to go about it. So if you give them a tangible way to make a difference, saying we're looking for 20 volunteers for a Saturday morning between the hours of 12 and 10, or 10 and 12, I positively can get just from the local community, say we need 20 people to do this and this game. I mean, I could probably get a day yes from the teacher saying for 2 hours on a Saturday I need this activity to be managed. But it's creating a network. It's sort of, you know, explaining what our project is and creating a network of volunteers that we can tap into. And ultimately, my dream is that in every colony in India, you have the community, the privileged community, who is looking out for the underprivileged community, so that, you know, us, our school in Chanakyapuri is going to help the government schools, is going to help the slum communities, is going to give them a way to improve their level of standards of living.
Yeah, you were talking about the raids. How does that apply to children on the street? Like, do the police or the government ever stop that?
So there's still laws around child forced beggary. And the thing is, I don't know if you've ever spoken to, if you've ever spoken to a beggar, a child.
Yeah, but my hand is so
limiting. So basically the money that you give doesn't really go to them, they get a small fraction. So suppose they earn, like, from begging 150 rupees in a day, they will probably get about 30 rupees. That's about what they get. So you can be really generous and give them 500 rupees, but they won't get to keep it because there are people, adults, who are keeping an eye out to see how much they're getting. And they get their daily wages and they get food, but they don't get to keep the money. So sometimes they say the best thing you can do is give them food, is to give them biscuits, to give them banana, to give them boiled eggs, things that are nutritious, because adults are not going to keep that. Raids and rescues, I think the police is not getting involved in it right now. I actually just asked Kerala Youth Organization that question, is that what's our role around beggary? He's like, you know, there's a lot of discussion around that. The police is trying to get rid of, like, if you notice, there's certain flyovers that they used to have 50 beggars and now there's a lot less. So it is improving. I personally think that the situation in India is improving, but it's a very slow path. So the problems are so vast.
So it's not seen as straightforward as going to come back for him getting them out.
That's not the case.
Yeah. Do you think not having education has anything to do with the injuries and health issues kids get from working?
Definitely. It's all, see, that's what I was telling you, is that these are all mind holes and they're all connected. So if you look in the community, I mean, the nails alone, I mean, I just want to take a nail cutter and cut their nails and just be like, you know what, just from keeping clean nails, you'll be so much healthier. So education prevents you from good health and hygiene and sanitation. So a big part of our program is partnering with, you know, Max has a CSR, Max Foundation has a CSR initiative. They can run health and hygiene workshops for the community. So, you know, every mother, every father, I mean, yes, there's people out there who are not wonderful, but the vast majority of mothers and fathers want good for their children. They feel proud when their child is looking beautiful and clean and is going to school and getting a good education. They do want that. So they can't always provide that for their family. probably aspects that Phil Ashley is working on.
What do you think the police could be more involved with in this whole situation?
You know, the problem is that the police are being paid off by people. So if you file a report, the police oftentimes in these communities are very easily bribed. So suppose there was a case of rape. The person who committed the offense will tip off or tip the police so that the police doesn't file an official report, and so the corruption in the police is definitely an issue. Now, not every police person is corrupt, and you can work with, if you feel, it's that, you know, I also feel is that sometimes if you sort of work with the police to know that they're being watched, there's people that were like the person I work with, Rakesh, I asked him if he could come, now he's traveling, I see, he said that we're forging relationships with the police so that they know that if anything is being messed around with the people in this camp, there is an NGO who's looking after them, who's taking care of them, who's going to say, that's wrong, go up again, we'll come with you. And ultimately, our goal is to not solve problems for them. Our goal is to teach them how to solve their own problems, because otherwise, once we go, they'll slip back into being dependent on us. And so the guiding principles of our project is to give nothing for free. Nothing is free. We're not going to give food. We're not going to. We're not going to fix their problems. You know, if they don't have light, one of the big issues is that they don't have light at night near the bathrooms. Now, tempting to just go put a light up. What will that do next time they have the problem? Is to teach them how to solve that problem. It's like, these are the government agencies. This is the way you, this is how you write a letter. This is how you stand up. This is the person you call. And you counsel them through it so that you teach them how to solve their own problems. Because ultimately, you don't want to create a dependency. You know, within 3 years, they should be mobilized to support themselves.
What do you think the biggest issue with raids are? What could be done to make it more successful?
You know, I don't have so much experience around raids because I haven't been so involved in it. But yeah, there is a danger aspect to raids if you have a large community. I mean, you know, there's a film that has just been made on Kailash Satyarthi. I don't know if you know the Sundance Film Awards. They won the best documentary for Sundance. So you'll see a lot of the footage from raids around that. And there, it's dangerous for sure. But partnering with the police is a big aspect because you have police protection and they know that they can't, you know, put, because now it's a law. So different, an NGO can work with the police in that district to make a plan about when the rape will happen. So initially, Bachpan Bachao Andolan, this organization, would go and schedule a raid in the middle of the night to take the kids and bring them to safety. But now you partner with the police, you don't have to go at night, you can go during the day.
Thank you, Ruthie, so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Education that would help with, like,
my, yeah. Yeah.